till the day you call me home. Singing, oh, Lord, keep me in the moment. Help me live with my eyes wide open. Cause I don't wanna miss what you have.
Good morning. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us here at Lakewood United Methodist Church, those of you who are with us in your seats, present in this space, and also those of you who are present with us online. So grateful to be here. My name is the Reverend Ben David Hensley. I am proud to serve as pastor to this community and this congregation here on the corner of 14th and Brentwood. Friends, as you join us in worship this morning, please make yourselves comfortable. There is coffee in the back. If you would like to sip on some throughout the service, you're welcome to drink it in the sanctuary. Also, inside of your bulletin are these little welcome cards that you can fill out if you need to either update information, contact information with us, or if you're visiting us and want us to have your information so that we can contact you or reach out to you, we would love to do that. This card also has a place where you can write prayers, and if you turn those into the plate when it's passed around during the offering time, we will collect those, get the information, also be praying for you. So feel free to fill that out, drop it into the offering plate when it is passed around later in service. Those of you who are joining us online, you can always reach out to us at info@lumc.net to share that information with us or to provide prayer concerns that you'd like us to lift up in prayer. Now, my friends, at this time, I invite you to rise in body and or spirit in order to share the peace of Christ with one another. The peace of Christ be with you. Amen. Friends, dangerous and inclement weather prevented us from coming together on Ash Wednesday this past week. Ash Wednesday is a marker of the beginning of the Lenten journey of self-reflection and discernment, originating from the 11th century Christian church. The journey of repentance is about turning around. That's literally the origin of that word, metanoia, is to turn around, so that we might be in right relationship with God. So in a sense, and in line with our worship series, we are looking for love once again. When we look to God for love, not simply for the approval of others and start with our own turning, we participate in the turning around also of the world. So we mark the beginning of this journey of repentance by marking our forehead with ashes. Now, this is completely voluntary. Those of you who are here know that if you don't want to receive ashes, this morning, you do not have to come up. We wanted to make sure that we did this ritual together, though, so that we can, in an embodied way, still mark the beginning of our Lenten journey, even if we started perhaps 3 days late. So at this time, those who wish to receive ashes can come forward after the following prayer. Friends, will you pray with me? Forgiving God, prepare us for this 40-day journey of spiritual preparation, like you prepared Jesus before his sojourn into the wilderness. As we come forward, reminded of our mortality and committed to a time of reflection, repentance, and reconciliation, grant us the grit to take this journey to its full completion. Even as we face the truth of death, symbolized through the mark of ashes on our forehead, remind us how death does not have power over the life you have planted within us. Even for the moments where we fall short in our repentance, remind us of your grace always extended to us as we seek forgiveness. Even if we are not accustomed to a Lenten discipline, remind us of all the ways you are constantly reaching out to us for connection, and keep us curious and possibly willing to engage with something new. As we are marked by ashes this morning, may we learn not to fear death, but to accept death as a part of life. In all of these things, we pray in your holy name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And all God's people said, I now invite you to come forward. You may arise and come. Shall return. this time, the children who are here, if they so desire, are invited to head to Sunday school this morning. Friends, I invite you to join me as we prepare to enter into a time of prayer this morning. Prayer, as I say every Sunday, is more than just the words that we say. Prayer is about intention. We can do it with our voices or our body. Receiving ashes is a form of prayer. Here at Lakewood United Methodist Church, we want to provide space for all expressions of praying. So this time of prayer that we are about to embark upon will remain open for a few minutes. You're invited to stay in place if you wish and reflect in silence. You're invited to remain seated or even stand. You might feel called to utter prayers out loud. We have two stations here near the front where you're invited to come forward to light a candle as a visual sign of prayer to God. And if you're joining us online, you can also light a candle in your own home and participate in this time of prayer with us. However you feel called to pray, and in whatever posture, I invite you to pray with me in this time right now. Our praying time together will conclude in 3 to 5 minutes or so with the final blessing that I will offer. Let us pray. Gracious God, hear our prayer of gratitude for the ways that you have blessed us, for the ways that our city has stepped up to provide vital shelter for our neighbors experiencing homelessness when the weather became deadly cold, for those who came to help us clean our community garden space yesterday. We give you thanks and praise. Gracious God, hear our prayers for those who are hungry for bread but only find stones. For those who seek justice but can find no advocate who will help them. For those who are in danger and have no one watching over them. We lift up always the people of Ukraine, those still reeling in the aftermath of historic earthquakes, students in our schools terrorized by gun violence and the threat of gun violence, and those who are constantly struggling in the throes of poverty and homelessness. Gracious God, hear our prayers for those who are struggling, who are ill, who are recovering. Specifically this morning, we pray for Gary Dyer, Ellie Schuneman, Rhonda Bonner, Mary Ann Watkins, Matt, and the Flores family. We lift up these prayers that have been uttered out loud and also the prayers that have remained unspoken but continue to reside in the depths of our hearts. And now we lift up the prayer your son taught us to pray, proclaiming that prayer with the boldness of children as we say together the words, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever.
For hymn number 2105 in the Black Hymnal.
Your hear these words from Matthew 4, 1 to 11. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tested by the devil. He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterward he was famished. The tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus said to him, "Again it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, "All these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." Then Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Friends, I just want to take a moment to share the joy that I have and the pride that I have of being a constituent of Lakewood. This week, as I'm sure you're aware, some very dangerously cold weather, weather that we've seen now three times in this peculiar winter season this year, weather that's particularly dangerous for people who are exposed for a prolonged period of time. In the past, all of you have stepped up to put your church forward as a shelter, or we've partnered with another congregation who's done the same. But this time around, this week, I was really proud of our city that opened up a gym in the Whitlock Rec Center and contracted with a company to run the shelter. So the city invested our taxpayer dollars and our taxpayer-funded public facilities to save lives. And I can't think of a better use of some of the publicly owned assets of our city or a more morally just thing for our city to have done this week. And so I just wanted to share my gratitude and witness to God's provision in the midst of that. Will you pray with me? Gracious God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be an acceptable offering in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. And all God's people said. So as you can probably tell, we're starting this unique worship series for Lent. It's named after the popular country song, "Looking for Love in All the Wrong Places." Don't ask me to sing it because I don't really like country music and I don't know how it sounds. But you might find the Scrabble tiles to be a bit of a peculiar visual focus for worship during the season of Lent. So in my own experience of playing Scrabble, I never conveniently have the letters that spell out the word that I'm looking for just placed in front of me the moment I start my turn. For much of the game of Scrabble, I'm rearranging tiles, trying to find word or letter combinations that can help me obtain the highest score possible. And, you know, sometimes, as I'm sure you're aware, there are really obvious words that you can play, words like "the" or "an," but those are often not the best choices, right? They don't score very high. And I think that we do this in our search for love. We find a whole lot of less substantial things to replace the actual love-sized hole that exists in all of us that God is meant to fill. We look for love in places where love really isn't being provided. We even replace love with things that can sometimes hurt us. Our passage this morning finds Jesus right after his baptism by his cousin John. He's fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, and Scripture says that Jesus was famished. So here comes Satan, attempting to coax Jesus to use his divine power to transfigure stones into bread. Now, whenever I hear the words, "man cannot live on bread alone," I have to point out, especially if I'm preaching on it, that this is a very ironic thing to say in Scripture. and it would have stuck out to Jesus' audience and the audience of the gospel writers who wrote this story, because sourdough whole grain bread, which was the only kind available at that time, actually does contain all of the nutrients biologically needed by human beings to survive. It's got all the proteins, it's got all the vitamins. The act of fermentation on a whole grain of wheat transforms the dough into something that is universally nourishing for human beings. So quite literally, you actually could live on bread alone. So Jesus is talking about something a little bit different, I think. He's quoting a part of Scripture that's saying something a bit deeper. Jesus is speaking about a deeper life, I think. Jesus' journey into the wilderness was something deeper than just a trip he intended to take before he began his ministry along the shores of Galilee. Jesus' fast was a spiritual act, bringing him closer to his Father, closer to a sense of understanding the pain of hunger that so many of his neighbors experienced, and removing the distraction of eating from the work of contemplation and prayer. Jesus was choosing to fast, but if he followed Satan's encouragement, then how could he feel up to the task of self-denial required of him to lead his people into a new understanding of God's love? If Jesus could just snap his fingers to create bread, how could he even understand his neighbor who was hungry? See, Jesus' goal, I would argue, wasn't to feed the hungry. Jesus' goal was to convince and inspire his community to make sure that everyone was fed. So Jesus needed to lean on something stronger than his hunger or his desire to experience the pleasure of being sated. Jesus needed to rely on his faith. And he says, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. So Satan, undeterred, tries another angle. He decides to try and prey upon Jesus' human insecurity. If you're so powerful, Satan implies, then prove it by falling off this temple roof I've put us on magically to demonstrate how your power will keep you from dying or even being hurt. But if Jesus could just snap his fingers and experience physical immortality and invulnerability, then what was the point of Jesus' sacrifice, right? How can Jesus demonstrate as God his willingness to love us so deeply he would even die for us if dying isn't really costly for Jesus? The inevitability of death is what gives meaning to life. And so Jesus needed to lean on something stronger than his human fear of death, his faith. And so he again quotes the scriptures saying, do not put the Lord your God to the test. So finally, Satan brings Jesus to a high mountaintop, right on the top of Mount Evans, right? Where he can survey the kingdoms and palaces representing the pinnacle of human achievement. And he tells Jesus the lie that prosperity gospel Christianity tells us today. All of these things I will give you if you will fall down and worship me. Since the beginning of time, my friends, we have measured our worth, our belovedness, our humanity on the power and wealth that we have accumulated. We worship as celebrities, the powerful and the wealthy today. We have churches who prop up pastors as avatars of the excessive wealth all of us wish that we had. We obsess over the pageantry of British royal pomp and circumstance. Satan's last temptation is a doozy. And I think it can be very easy for us to believe that Jesus didn't have a hard time resisting it, but I don't think that's necessarily true. The Roman Empire always, 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 always overshadows the story of Jesus' ministry in the Gospels. I bring it up all the time because so much of our Christian origin story emerges out of this context of colonization and oppressive military occupation. So before and after Jesus' life, his people engaged in armed insurrection against their occupiers. Throughout history, Judea, Jerusalem in particular, was frequently the target of marauding empires and armies who sought to despoil it. Jesus could have ended the suffering of thousands with the power, wealth, and military might needed to overthrow the empire. Jesus could have been the king that Herod never was for his people. He could have ushered in a reign of peace, instituted justice and righteousness throughout the land with that kind of power. But then, unfortunately, it all becomes about Jesus, doesn't it? The human Jesus, let's say, and not God. Jesus taking power like that would not lead people into a greater relationship with his Father in heaven and thus a deeper life of faith. It would lead them rather to worship the human Jesus King, propped up by the evil one. The Jesus who had to succumb to the temptation of Satan, the great adversary, the liar, the accuser, in order to gain the power he had. A power conditional on Jesus' relationship with one whose goal for the cosmos was that of death and decay, rather than life and flourishing. Satan's promise here is a false promise, no matter how tempting it actually is. And so Jesus needed to lean on something stronger than his human fear of powerlessness and vulnerability. He needed to lean on his faith. And so he quotes the scriptures again, "Worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Jesus shows us in this first week of Lent that in our search for love, we should look for the resistor, the one who can withstand the temptations of pleasure, security, and power in order to pursue the fruits of the love God has for us. When we resist the urge to find the easiest pleasure, or a false sense of security, or the accumulation of wealth, power, and prestige, we begin to make room for God to enter in. So I wonder, what are the tempting forces that we need to focus on resisting today? What if we need to resist the empty community we try to create by having a common enemy? It's so easy to define who we are by what we are against. Anger is abundant in our public conversation. What if that's what we're being called to resist? What if we need to resist the urge to hoard what we are afraid of losing? I still remember the empty aisles in grocery stores where toilet paper should have been during the pandemic. What other things are we hoarding to fill the love-sized hole within us in vain? Is it money? Is it power? Is it assets? What if we need to resist the removal of all pain, period, in our lives? The desire to never experience pain again. What if we need to resist that? In her book, Dopamine Nation, Dr. Anna Lemke writes this. She says, "We're living in a time of unprecedented access to high reward, high dopamine stimuli. Drugs, food, news, gambling, shopping, gaming, texting, Facebooking, Instagramming, YouTubing, tweeting. The increased numbers, variety, and potency is staggering. The smartphone is the modern-day hypodermic needle, delivering digital dopamine 24/7 for a wired generation. As such, we have all become vulnerable to compulsive overconsumption." She continues to argue in her book that by constantly seeking to escape pain, all that we've managed to do is actually make the pain that we do experience more unbearable. So maybe we need to resist our tendency to numb and escape pain. There's a laundry list of temptations that we could come up with for us to resist in order to make room for love in our lives. I hope that for this season of Lent, you might consider how your Lent fast, if you're doing one, could be an act of resistance against the one who whispers temptations in your ears like Satan did to Jesus in the wilderness. And I also hope that in your resistance, that you are ready to possibly fail. And that isn't the end of the world, nor a reason to feel shame, nor the end of your worthiness and belovedness as a human being. I hope that you discover in your resistance during Lent what Jesus knew deep within him, that God is with us, that we are not alone, and that God is stronger than the temptations. And where Jesus was able to reconnect with God by remembering God's work, specifically from the book of Deuteronomy in our passage this morning, perhaps you might find similar anchor points in Scripture or in the prayers and poetry and hymnody of our church, in your own journaling, in your own prayer life that can bolster your resolve to resist all of the wrong places that Satan is inviting us to find love. Let's resist the false promises today that only lead us the larger emptiness, and instead turn toward that great love who made us and created all of us to be inherently beloved and worthy of love. May we, all of us, embark on a holy Lent. And all God's people said. That brain, y'all. That brain.
You know, we switch things up occasionally, and it messes the staff up. I wanted to just talk to you about how we've been using, again, our building and our land this week in an abundance fashion. So this week, we began planning for the garden that's at the back of our parking lot, and we had a class on planning your garden, and then Saturday we came together and we cleaned up the garden, and honestly we filled the whole dumpster and like half of the recycling, so it is very clean, quite clean back there at this point. And then yesterday afternoon we hosted Sustainable IBER, which is one of the neighborhood associations here that works on sustainability projects. We hosted about 20 folks, and they we learned how to do what is called winter sowing for native plants, which is how we care for God's world in one way. It helps our pollinators, it helps butterflies, you name it, these naturally growing plants help. And so we planted plants that hopefully mine will come up and we'll find in the garden this, this summer in milk jugs. And I'd like to encourage you, a number of you are involved in your neighborhood associations. And it's so very, very important how we meet our neighbors, how we treat our neighbors. I don't live in the IBER neighborhood, but I'm involved in both IBER neighborhood associations. Maddie there in the front row is involved in Two Creeks. And, you know, I live in Briarwood Hills. We don't really have a neighborhood association, but I would encourage you, out of abundance, out of your own abundance, to really help transform your own neighborhood where you live and get nice and involved. And if you don't have one, come and see me, and I'll hook you up with one of the IBER Neighborhood Associations to participate. So thank you for, again, allowing us to use this building in so many ways that benefit our neighborhood.
Let me also add just another abundance report that's going to mortify him that I'm going to do this. But we have in our midst someone who successfully defended their dissertation and on their way to getting a PhD in statistics, and that's David Brown. He successfully defended it in the summer, but I wanted to congratulate him. David, thank you for letting me do that. I think it's really awesome that we have you with us, and I'm really proud as the spouse of someone who's writing her dissertation. I am intimately aware of how hard that is, and so I wanted to make sure we recognized and celebrated that achievement. Friends, will you pray with me? Generous God, as we remember Jesus' temptation in the wilderness, we acknowledge the temptation that pursues many of us to measure our worth, our power, and our security by what we have. As we offer our gifts to you this morning, we pray that you might deliver us from the temptation of building our lives around what belongs or what we think belongs to us. Continually lead us to the conviction that what matters is that we belong to you. We pray this prayer in the name of our Savior and Redeemer, and all God's people said, Father, Son, and
Please be seated. This is an invitation to be set into motion. At Lakewood UMC, we worship with purpose. Every week, we want to offer to you an invitation to continue living out your faith, to join in fellowship with other believers, or engage in deeper learning. We call it an invitation to be set in motion. Lent is traditionally a time to scale back, to make things more simple, to clear away extraneous distractions in order to give more of our time and attention to God. Embrace the fasting your spirit calls you to do. This isn't just a sad season. It is a season of reflection and repentance, and that can be painful. What is it you need to turn away from, and what is it you need to turn towards? Each week, we will find how love shows up in Scripture on our journey toward Christ's passion and what that tells us about where we can find love around us today. This Lent, we will participate in the Mountain Sky Conference study Through the Wilderness of Gender. It begins tomorrow, Monday, February 27th. We will watch this study together with Phillips UMC at Phillips. The ministers of both churches will also be participating. This study is open to all and is specifically designed for persons seeking to understand what gender is, how the world sees gender, and how gender operates and is experienced in our own lives. Persons seeking to gain a better understanding of their own gender, and persons seeking to understand how our relationship to gender and ourselves can be related to our experiences of faith and spirituality. After the service today, we will be collecting warm weather clothing from 11 to 1 p.m. Finally, Friday is our community partner 40 West Arts District's first Friday event. It is Mardi Gras themed and has special music and art. We will leave from the church at 6 p.m. There is more information about all of the Worship with Purpose events in the narthex. Now please stand for the closing hymn, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling, found in the Red United Methodist Hymnal.
Come down, things in us.
friends, I invite you to turn and face the door. As we look out into the place where God is sending us, I invite you to remember that the work of resistance here is the work of making sure that the right things enter in and fill that love-sized gap in all of us. The work of resistance is making sure that we have left a clear pathway open for God to enter, for God's grace to enter into us, so that we can be filled with overflowing with something that has no end, something that cannot be exhausted, so that we can be poured out for the benefit of our neighbor, our neighbors who are suffering, our neighbors who are experiencing loneliness and isolation, our neighbors who need to hear good news. So go from this place ready to resist, ready to keep that space open for God, ready to pursue a holy Lent. God's peace be with you.